Okay, it's January 26, 2018. We're going to get started with our verse by verse in Galatians chapter 2. We're going to do Galatians chapter 2, verse 11, and we're going to go to verse 16. We're going to pick up where we left off last time. And what we're doing is, this week we're going to be talking about the reason for Paul's rebuke to Peter, and this is where we're picking up where we left off. We're going to be talking about Paul's going to publicly confront Peter, this week. Paul's going to expose Peter's hypocrisy in this group and that Jerusalem council that they've got going on for the little flock. And then Paul's going to remind Peter that they're justified by Christ and not by the law, as far as that justification goes. So what we'll do is we'll open up in prayer, and then we'll go ahead and go through our verse-by-verse study, picking up where we left off last time in Galatians chapter 2. So, Heavenly Father, Lord, we're thankful for this day of grace. We're thankful for your word rightly divided. Lord, that we continue to be your ambassadors, study your word, and have it work effectually in us as we believe it. Amen.
Amen.
So, in verse, what we went through, we studied Galatians chapter 1, Galatians chapter 2. We saw that there was the gospel of circumcision and the gospel of the uncircumcision. We're here and we're reading about how Paul's explaining how he went to the Jerusalem council. He brought Barnabas, he brought Titus, and he's there with the essential pillars of the little flock, which is Cephas, James, and John. And he's going to be explaining to them certain things at this meeting. And they've already extended to them the right hands of fellowship. So they go to Paul and say, essentially, Paul, you're the man on the scene with the right information. So Paul's not moved about by men and men of reputation and men of influence, especially unsaved men. And when he goes to the apostles, he's not moved by men of the law or men with a different message. So he's not moved about by different things. When God gives a message, Paul adheres to it, and Paul sticks with it, and Paul continues with it, irregardless of who men are. So he's going to continue with that nonetheless, with his message that was given to him, not of man, but of God. And this is what you read about in Galatians chapter 1. So as we get into verse 11, chapter 2, Galatians chapter 2, verse 11 says, "But when Peter was come to Antioch, I withstood him to the face, because he was to be blamed." So we're seeing here that Peter was to be blamed. And we're going to find out why in the next couple of verses. But it says, "When Peter was come to Antioch," he goes, "I withstood him to the face, because he was to be blamed." So when somebody, was to be blamed for an issue or a mistake, Paul didn't try to hide, or Paul didn't try to just let it go. When there was something to be blamed, he was stood to the face. And this is what our pattern does. This is what the Apostle Paul does. So when there's a mistake, Paul addresses it. Paul deals with it. Paul, in our daily walk or our work with the Lord, when there's an issue that we need to face, we need to address it, as Paul did with Peter. He says in verse 11, he says that he was stoned to the face. It was because he was to be blamed. And so, and this is talking about Peter, who has the binding and loosing powers, and he's got the keys to the kingdom. He gets himself in trouble. So, we see that there. If we look at, say, 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 20. 1 Timothy chapter 5, and verse 20. So you'll see, when it comes to rebuking or withstanding to the face, there's a reason for it. He says, "Then that sin rebuke before all, that others also may fear." There's a purpose. When Paul addresses Peter, that's going to get the others to be kind of nervous about following Peter or addressing what is it that Peter's doing, so that they themselves don't make the same mistake. So he's going to address them before all. So when somebody sins, you address them before all, that others also fear and don't do the same thing. And so, if you also look at, let's see, 2 Corinthians 5:16, there's also another lesson to learn from this, 2 Corinthians 5:16. And this was also, this is mainly something taught about Christ, but we can also learn this about Peter as well. 2 Corinthians 5:16 says, "Wherefore, henceforth know we no man after the flesh, yea, though we have known Christ after the flesh, yet now henceforth know we him no more." So, it says, "Wherefore, henceforth know we no man after the flesh." So, if there's people looking at Peter and saying, "Well, this is Peter, you know, you can't talk to Peter like that, you can't address Peter like that, you can't withstand him to the face, this is Peter who has the keys to the kingdom, this is Peter who has the binding and loosing powers of Matthew chapter 16. This is Peter. You can't." The Apostle Paul says, "Well, you know, if he's making a mistake, I can address his mistake. I mean, I can address him." And because we've got a ministry of our own to uphold, as long as it's glorifying God, he can be addressed. A mistake is a mistake. A sin is a sin, and that can be addressed. Doesn't matter who it is. "Know we no man after the flesh," 2 Corinthians 5:16 says. What's more important is the ministry, is serving the Lord. And so as we see that there, then we go back to Galatians chapter 2. It says, "But when Peter once came to Antioch, I withstood him to the face, because he was to be blamed." So he was to be blamed, and Paul addressed it. It says, "For before that, a certain came from James. He did eat with the Gentiles. But when they were come, he withdrew and separated himself, fearing them which were of the circumcision." So this is the issue of what's happening. So when it says, "For before that, certain Jews came from James, he did eat with the Gentiles." So when we go back and we look at certain issues, back in Acts chapter 10, you saw people like Cornelius joining up with the little flock, and there's other Gentiles most likely joining up with the little flock. And so Peter knew, back in Acts chapter 10, there was a vision given to him, probably, you know, three times. And let's see if I can find exactly where that was. If we look in Acts chapter 10, saying, you know, through this vision showing Peter, shown them all the animals on the earth on a white sheet. And he's saying, you know, rise, Peter, kill and eat. Go ahead, you can eat anything now. And Peter, and you can read this in 2 Timothy as well. And so what he's saying is, go ahead, you can go ahead and eat all things. And so he's saying, go ahead, you know, you can go ahead and eat anything. And so Peter is doubting this. Peter's saying, what are you talking about? All I know is Leviticus chapter 11, essentially. And so what he's doing is he's showing the sheet vision three times, saying, no, Peter, go ahead. You can eat that. You can allow the Gentiles to eat. And it's, you know, this whole thing about the Jerusalem councils, that's not about circumcision of the flesh, but circumcision of the heart. If they really want to be joining up with the little flock, they have to have the right, they have to have the heart of a Jew, so to speak. Not the flesh of a Jew, but the heart of a Jew. And so it's all about being more oriented towards the things of God, whether they join up with the little flock or whether they join up with the body of Christ. The Gentiles are welcome to join up with the groups, whichever group they want at this time. And so, as we go back to Galatians chapter 2 and verse 12, it says, for before that, certain came from James, James being one of the pillars of the little flock. He did eat with the Gentiles. Peter used to eat with the Gentiles because they were welcome to join the little flock. And it says, but when they were come, when these Jews walked in the room or where they walked in the place, he withdrew and separated himself, fearing them which were of the circumcision. So Peter, you know, the apostle Peter, would sit and eat with the Gentiles and welcome them in and eat with them in the little flock, in the audience of the little flock. Then when the Jews would walk in, Peter would all of a sudden get worried that people would see him eating with Gentiles, so he'd walk away from them. And so when he would do that, then the Gentiles might feel like it would wound their conscience, or maybe they get worried that they do something wrong. Why is Peter walking away from him? Why is, you know, should we adjust our lifestyle to be more like the Jews? Should we change ourselves to be more like this? Should we you know, do something more, something less? What are we doing wrong? So the Apostle Paul is going to address Peter to his face and say, Peter, you're the leader here. Why are you treating mistreating Gentiles who want to join up with the little flock? They joined up with you so that you could help them. Why are you walking away from them just because Jews walked in the room? And so this is essentially what he's going to say to them here. So he says in verse 12, you know, because after that vision was given to Peter three times, Peter should have learned from God, you know, but yet it takes Paul to show Peter. You know, and since Genesis 12, Israel and Gentiles were meant to eat together. You know, Israel was to be the channel of blessing. They were to be the leaders. And yet, you're seeing that things have changed. Things are changing as this is a transition period. And so we see that in verse 12. For before that, certain came from James. He did eat with the Gentiles. So he did at one point. And Peter knew the middle wall partition was down. He knew all these things. He says, but when they were come, you know, the Jews would walk in, he withdrew himself. He withdrew and separated himself, fearing them, which were of the circumcision. So Peter was nervous. Peter was afraid. You know, it's not supposed to be like that. So Paul says, I got to do something about this. I need to clear up Peter's thinking. Paul's the one who is there at the Jerusalem Council, just as a intellectual participant, and yet he's there. And says, "Well, I got to clear this up because you know they're having a meeting about circumcision. They're having a meeting about you know what they could eat. They're having a meeting about certain things, and Peter's not acting right. And he's the Apostle Peter, and so me as the Apostle Paul, I've got to clear up the Apostle Peter's thinking so he can be the worthy leader." So they can both do what they need to do. And sometimes that's what had to happen. So verse 13, and other Jews dissembled likewise with him, insomuch that Barnabas also was carried away with their dissimulation. Peter's influence as the Apostle Peter was so was such a big influence. So you see in verse 13, other Jews dissembled likewise with him. You see, it's so much that Barnabas was also carried away. And Paul brought Barnabas and Titus with him to this meeting. And when Peter saw the Jews walk in the room, Peter walked away. And so all the other Jews walked away from the Gentiles, and they went to the other side of the room or whatever it is. And at one point, Barnabas goes, well, maybe I should walk away too from these Gentiles who want to join up with the little flock. Mm-hmm. And so Paul's going, what's going on here? Why is Barnabas walking away? Why are the Jews walking away from the Gentiles? Why is Peter walking away from the Gentiles? They're following what Peter's doing. So he said, Peter, you know, what kind of leader are you? These Gentiles came here to join up with you. They may be Gentiles, they may have things that they have to learn, whatever it is, but they're here for you. They're here to join up with you, to be rescued, and to join up with God and his plan and his program for the prophecy program for Israel. Don't walk away from them. So, we see that from verse 13, and we know from by the end of Acts 15, Paul's done with Barnabas. Paul's had it with Barnabas. By the end of Acts 15, Paul's had it with Barnabas. So we see that there. And that's due to their issue with John Mark. They fight over that. So they stop walking uprightly due to the leadership of Peter. And it says in verse 15, and so much that Barnabas also was carried away with their dissimulation. I mean, dissimulation is hiding under false appearance. So their dissimulation, you can see that in Romans 12 as well, you know, let love be without dissimulation. But dissimulation would be like a false appearance or hiding under a false appearance. You don't want to have your dissimulation be under a false appearance. You just want to have love with truth or walk in truth or have your life be with truth. You could live your life and have it be under dissimulation. You can be fake or plastic or, you know, that's when you're living your life and you're living it and you're just plastic. That's dissimulation. You're acting with dissimulation, and you don't want to do that. And that's what Peter was doing. And so Paul had to come in and fix that. And Paul had to say to Peter, you know, stop being plastic around the Gentiles. And that's what he had to say. So we see that there in verse 13. So he had to correct him with, you know, with doctrinal truth and then with his integrity. So that's what he did there. So when we get to verse 14, it says, but when I saw that they walked not uprightly according to the truth of the gospel, I said unto Peter before them all, if thou, being a Jew, livest after the manner of Gentiles and not as do the Jews, why compellest thou the Gentiles to live as do the Jews? So this is what the Apostle Paul says to Peter in order to rebuke him and to correct him and to get him to, you know, walk worthy and walk better. So he says, going back into verse 14, he says, but when I saw that they walked not uprightly according to the truth of the gospel, you know, knowing what the gospel is, and if we don't know what the gospel is, we've got it right up here above us. You know, 1 Corinthians 15:3-4, for I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. So we've got that up there, talking about the gospel. And so, what we have here in verse 14, he says, but when I saw that they walked not uprightly according to the truth of the gospel, he says, I said unto Peter before them all, so he's talking to them right in front of him. He says, if thou, Peter, being a Jew, livest after the manner of Gentiles, you know, and not as do the Jews, why compellest thou the Gentiles to live as do the Jews? So he's saying, if thou, you know, being a Jew, you know, being more bound to the law more than the Gentiles would ever be, you know, he's saying, so if thou being a Jew, you know, Peter, you're a Jew, you're more bound to the law than the Gentiles would ever be, livest after the manner of Gentiles, you know, now that they can live after the manner of Gentiles, due to the fact that, you know, the sheep was let down in Acts 10 three times, as we read about that before. They can eat all manner of food now. They're not needing to be circumcised like they were back in Genesis, like we can read about. They can live after the manner of Gentiles up to a point, to a certain extent. So he's saying, you're being a Jew, you know, being a Jew, live us after the manner of Gentiles and not as to the Jews. So, you know, Peter, you in Acts chapter 10, you met with Cornelius, you ate with Cornelius, you spoke with them, you met up with them. Others are coming into the little flock now, so you're living after the manner of Gentiles in order to reach them. Why are you compelling them to live as do the Jews? Why are you compelling these Gentiles to act like Jews when the Gentiles are coming into the little flock of their own free will? Why are you forcing them to be so much like Jews? You know, when God himself has said they can eat anything they want, and they can, you know, circumcision is of the heart and not of the flesh. So if God said that, why are you forcing the issue? And why are you forcing them to live as to the Jews when the Gentiles themselves, you know, don't have to? And that's what he's saying to them. He's saying, you know, when we read that again in verse 14, if thou being a Jew livest after the manner of Gentiles, and not as do the Jews, why compellest thou? And why are you compelling the Gentiles to live as do the Jews? And why are you compelling them to live so hard, you know, to live as do the Jews, when you were just, you know, living as the Gentiles to reach him? You know, Peter, so he has to rebuke Peter to his face and say these things. Because it can go both ways. The Gentiles can join up with the little flock, and the Gentiles can join up into the body of Christ. And the little flock, if they wanted to become part of the body of Christ, the little flock could become part of the body of Christ. At this point, it's a transition period. So they could go into both groups and vice versa at during this time. So that's why it's the way it is on this one. So that's what we're seeing in this, in verse 14. Peter made himself a transgressor by this way. So he's saying, let's see, walked uprightly according to the truth of the gospel. He says that unto Peter, and so he's rebuking them. He's making sure that they're made aware of their errors and their mistakes, and that they get things fixed. So it says in verse 15, we who are Jews by nature, not sinners of the Gentiles. And he's going to continue in 16. Knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Jesus Christ, that we might not be justified by the faith of Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. So when we see that there in verse 15, it says, we who are Jews by nature are not sinners of the Gentiles. It's not that the Jews didn't sin, not that they're sinners of the Jews, but what he's talking about, he's saying, you know, Jews by nature and sinners of the Gentiles. Now if you look at, say, Acts 16, verse 37, let's go there for a minute. Acts 16, verse 37. What we see there, it says, but Paul said unto them, they have beaten us openly and condemned, being Romans, and have cast us into a prison, and now do they thrust us out privily? Nay, verily, but let them come themselves and fetch us out. And the sergeants told these words unto the magistrates, and they feared when they heard that they were Romans. And they came and besought them, and brought them out, and desired them to depart up unto their city. So what you're seeing there, going back to verse 15, is, we are Jews by nature, not sinners of the Gentiles. You're seeing that, you know, Paul himself is a Roman. And you're seeing this by example here. And then in Acts 22:3, I think it's the same point there. In Acts 22:3, what you're going to see is, He says, I am verily a man, which am a Jew, born in Tarsus, a city in Cilicia, yet brought up in this city at the feet of Gamaliel, and taught according to the perfect manner of the law of the fathers, and was zealous toward God, as ye are all this day. So Paul is both a Roman and a Jew, as we see from these verses here. And so what he's going to address here is, not that the Jews didn't sin, but that he's more sarcasm to Peter. It's the sarcastic speech that he's going to Peter about, because he's rebuking him. He's rebuking him to his face. And he's saying, we who are Jews by nature, not sinners of the Gentiles, Paul being a Jew, and Paul talking to Peter. And this is where we go to verse 16. He's saying, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, and we know that ourselves. We can read that in Romans chapter 3, and we can read that through in Romans chapter 4, and Titus chapter 3, that knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ. Now we know that the faith of Jesus Christ, that gets destroyed quite a bit in the grace movement. The faith of Jesus Christ has been described as Jesus Christ having faith in certain things. But Jesus Christ is God. Jesus Christ doesn't have to have faith in anything. Jesus Christ doesn't have faith in anything. It's the faith of Jesus Christ is faith, meaning doctrines. Like when you hear that faith of our fathers burning, right? Those were beliefs and doctrines. So the faith of Jesus Christ is doctrines of Jesus Christ. It's another synonymous word, faith and doctrines. Otherwise, if Jesus has to have faith in something, you've got a problem with your Jesus. So he has to have faith in what God says, faith in this, faith in that. You've got a problem with your Jesus. And that's a lot of things that are happening in the grace movement, is you've got a Jesus who's attached to some canonic theology, and you've got a Jesus who's a lesser God. And that happens quite a bit, and unfortunately, it happens in the grace movement. So, when we see that in verse 16, it says, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by the faith of Christ, those doctrines, and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. So, we're seeing that, and we know that from those verses. We look at Romans chapter 3 and verse 19. This is what we were just mentioning a second ago. Romans chapter 3 and verse 19. Paul says this, in his epistle to the Romans. He says, now we know that what things soever the law saith, and say to them who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped, and all the world may become guilty before God. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. But now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. So the law is witnessing what's happening now. The prophets are witnessing. If you want to describe it in any way, what's happening now, that the righteousness of God without the law is manifested. Even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe, for there is no difference. So, when we see that in verse 20, therefore by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight. That's what we're reading in Galatians 3. For by the law is the